Last year also we talked about knowledge systems, Shruti, that which is heard, Vedas, Samhitas, Brahmanas, Aranyakas, Upanishads, for example, mantras, hymns, prayers, commentaries on hymns and rituals, rituals, philosophy. These are all the contents of these ancient texts. And the Smriti, that which is remembered, Vedangas, all grammar, meter, astronomy, rituals, itihasas, these texts, Puranas, Kavyas, Sutras, Shastras, various schools of philosophy, Nibandhas. Lots of things were present in India such that anybody could find intellectual expression within the frameworks that existed in the country with absolutely no conflict with the philosophy. We live in a strange world today where science is in conflict with the dominant religious systems of the world. The Abrahamic systems cannot accommodate science because of their history centricism. So over here, Darwin came about saying theory of evolution, and instantly the fundamentalists went on a warpath saying that, no, how is it possible? We didn't descend from that. God created man in his image, which means we look like God and perfectly. We cannot have descended from apes. So it caused great ruckus and outrage with them. And even till today, in United States, there are states, for example, Louisiana, where they used to stamp on the science textbooks that theory of evolution is only a theory. I'm not joking. Even during Jindal's time, even during the so-called enlightened Jindal's time, they're stamping on that in the history, high school history textbooks to tell the children, beware, what you're learning is not true. So such things are there. But in India, we never had a conflict of science and technology. And this is, sorry, science and philosophy. And there's a reason for that. If you look at this one, one-line descriptions of the Indian schools, we talked about this last year too. Nyaya said all knowledge is not intrinsically valid. Most knowledge is not valid unless proven. Truth exists whether we humans know it or not. Nakshapada Gautama was a rishi who said that. Vaisheshika, perception inference, Rishi Kannada. Samkhya, systematic enumeration, rational examination, Kapila. Purva Mimamsa talked on reflection, consideration, profound thought, investigation, examination, discussion. Rishi Jaimini talked about that. Uttara Mimamsa or Vedanta, up to 10 schools, and Adi Shankara, one of the exponents of Advaita. And you can see that the Indic thoughts admitted a lot of mechanisms for knowledge. These are profound statements over here, very profound statements that admit the process of knowledge gathering. If you look at this slide, the means of knowledge or pramana. In the Indian context, you can look at perception, inference, comparison, analogy, postulation, derivation from circumstances, negative proof, or shabda pramana, relying on word of experts. And you will see that every sampradaya in India only differed on under what authority are you admitting knowledge. That was the basis. For example, the Charvakas, the traditional atheists in Indian context, they only admitted perception. If I can see it, it's true. Otherwise, it's not. I reject the Vedas and other such things. And the Buddhists, they said only perception and inference, nothing else is valid as a mechanism for knowledge. This is what Buddha did, right? He went through a process of trials and tribulations and realized some truths. That's what he said. Vaisheshika similarly starts admitting several other things over here. Dvaita, Jainism, and Advaita takes from every school that you can see over here. So what is the bottom line? Today, we live in a world where if you're doing your PhD thesis, for example, maybe electrical engineering, you're going to say that I referred to this IEEE journal on the authority of this man who published in this journal. I am going to write my PhD thesis. I wrote this and reference number one, number two in a literature survey. This is what you do. You're relying on Shabda Pramana of some professor over there. Or maybe you're going to say this Nobel Prize winner said this. On the basis of that, I'm going to do my work. I'm referencing this man. On his authority, I'm writing my work. So this is the way we claim knowledge systems today, on the authority of somebody else who did something else. In ancient India, you can see it was a much more broader context in understanding the sources of knowledge, what is a valid means for knowledge, and so on. Today, you have a bigoted narrative in the Marxist textbook that have pulled the Buddhists, the Jains, and others out of the Indic dharmic context. However, the only difference of sampradaya is what is it that you're admitting as knowledge? That is the only difference. Everybody in the dharmic tradition believed in dharma, they believed in karma, they believed in reincarnation. This bedrock was there for all of them. The only things that differed was what is knowledge and how am I going to admit it? That was the only difference. And this picture over here summarizes a lot of Indic philosophies and knowledge. So it's good to know what is the goal of life. If you ask a Hindu what is the goal of life, the Hindu's goal of life is to dispel avidya from our minds about the true nature of who I am. And this dispelling avidya might happen in one lifetime or across multiple lifetimes depending on my karma. This is our understanding. So the Indic formula has been to dispel avidya and to gain vidya, and these are all the mechanisms for gaining knowledge. To gain knowledge of your true self, to understand there's no separation between creator and created, to understand that we are part of the cosmos, to understand that it's only ego and our attachment to the world of objects that prevents me from understanding the same Narayana is in both of us. These kind of ideas of Vedanta are all encoded when the Hindu is urged, one line statement, who is a Hindu, what is your goal life, to dispel avidya about my true existence, that Satchitananda is a state that I need to go into. That is the idea of a Hindu. In the Abrahamic tradition, the goal of life is to follow a divine dictated law. So God gave the 10 commandments to one of the prophets, and the goal in life is to follow those 10 commandments. Or Christ said certain things that his followers, the apostles, the gospels, they wrote down what he said. And if you believe that he died on the cross for your sins and he's the only way to the Father is through the Son, then you're saved. Either you go to heaven or eternal damnation, depending on the following of the law. Similarly, the Muslims also, if you believe that Muhammad, the prophet, he heard from Archangel Gabriel, who dictated the word of God to him. And if you follow the Quran's injunctions, then maybe the mercy of Allah, you'll be saved, or you'll have eternal damnation. So the goal in life for Abrahamic people is follow divine dictated law. None of this is relevant. None of this is relevant, because knowledge or any such thing is irrelevant. Your only goal, admission to heaven or eternal damnation. Those are the only two things. And the only formula is you follow a divine dictated law. Whereas in the Hindu ideas, it was you dispel avidya about your existence, and that will happen based on your karma phala, based in this lifetime or across multiple lifetimes, depending on the kind of life you live. And at every lifetime, you're enjoined upon, depending on which sampradaya you're born into, to admit certain knowledge based on these things. Okay, so this is all I wanted to say about knowledge systems, about how every knowledge in India, whether it was mathematics, astronomy, philosophy, whether it was grammar, prosody, music, medicine, you name it, everything coexisted with the philosophy of the land. Everything was embedded in the philosophy of the land. Everything gave citation to Brahma. This knowledge came from Brahma. Brahma taught it to the Ashwinis. Ashwinis taught it to maybe Punarvashvatraya or to Bharadwaj. Bharadwaj gave it to somebody, and so on. So every knowledge in the Indic context goes back and says, Brahma gave this knowledge.